Hello and welcome to the Daily Telegraph NRL Podcast. I'm Brent Reed. I'm joined today by Fatima Kadu, Pam Whaley. Let's jump straight into it. South Sydney, talk of the town they are at the moment, after another shocking result at the weekend. Where now, I guess, the obvious question. What do we think? This is your archetypal crisis.
From the outside looking in, it doesn't look like there are too many places for them to go. And we're talking both in terms of what seems to be happening internally at the club and the dysfunction there and the fractures there. And then when you look at their on-field performances and the changes they can make, it all seems very confusing. I can imagine JD's probably feeling very overwhelmed this week. We had a buzz and Bulldog had a story saying he's potentially 80 minutes from getting the punt.
Is it as simple as that, Pam? What are you getting rid of the coach? I mean, that's obviously where the buck stops, I guess, but does that solve their problems?
No, because who do they get to replace him as well? So it's probably the whole culture of the place at the moment, isn't it? Like, obviously he's at the head of it, but what is going on there? Because nothing seems right. I mean, it's obviously the players, it's the attitude within the place. It's obviously a little bit of JD as well. It's
the perfect storm.
The vibe,
right? Well, it's the imperfect storm.
You raise
a sort of valid point. Like, there was talk that Ben Hornby would be the caretaker for the rest of the year. Well, Ben's in there now and has been for at least last year. And this stems from last year, and this stretches back to midway through last year. Well, this is when the losing streak started. I think they've won like four of their last 17, 18 games or something.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think JD's, it's almost become untenable, it would seem. If they lose this weekend, they then go into a bye, and I don't know how he comes out of that bye with the coaching job. But I just don't know where they go in the short term.
Well, that's the thing. It's there doesn't seem to be any answers, at least immediately, for the problems they have. There's been so much talk about what is going wrong. You know, we saw the whole saga with Sam Burgess towards the end of last year. People saying, oh, well, you know, Sam Burgess was sort of made a pariah, but all of a sudden, maybe there was a bit of truth to what he's saying. And if the problem stems from inside the playing group, if that's where the root of the cause is, then getting rid of JD might not solve whatever the issues are at that club. And, you know, there's been stories about, we saw over the last couple of days, you know, an interesting insight into how the dynamic of that group works when there was a team meeting and JD, you know, praised Isaiah Tass, I think, the Jason Clark Award, I think they call it. And then, you know, he also said, oh, you know, and I'm going to add Latrell Mitchell to that. And Alex Johnston sort of took umbrage to that a little bit, saying, hold on, and pulled up the coach saying, hold on, he actually made his try-saving tackle on Josh Adakar, which JD was sort of pointing out as sort of, you know, for his effort and the rest of it, is an illegal tackle and potentially not a good move and could cost us, could have cost us the game, could have cost him a suspension. And I think that probably speaks to what Sam Burgess was talking about, that maybe there are players at that club that do get special treatment.
What I find really interesting about that information getting out is one thing South spoke about in the off-season was stop the leaks. We've got to stop talking about what happens in the dressing room.
Yeah.
And now the coach is under pressure and suddenly the leaks are starting again. And they're almost, they're destabilising him, which sort of suggests to me that they're preparing everyone for what's about
to
happen.
That article absolutely felt like it was very much, you know, laying the platform for JD to get the knife,
setting
you know,
the table, and just being like, this is what we're all dealing with here. Because if you're talking about accountability and things like that, which is what Sam Burgess was talking about in the first place, you could imagine how there are players in that team who have been held accountable for bad performances and things like that. We talk about, you know, Lachlan Ilias has been dropped and, you know, he's had his chances in first grade as well, but he's kind of been made the guy, a bit of a fall guy, right? Yeah. And how could you not feel resentment if as reported, there is a lack of accountability with some senior players?
I mean, Wayne's the obvious guy, right? I saw Craig got mentioned, Craig Bellamy, but Craig's staying in Melbourne. That's not even on the table, I would imagine.
Yeah. Well,
is Craig Wayne the logical guy to take over? In the long term, not in the short term. Obviously, he's got a job at the Dolphins, but for me, he's the only guy.
I think he kind of has to be, but then the plan, that was the plan in the first place though, right? So it was Wayne, and then he set this up as Jason Demetriou as the guy to take over. So then from then on, it's a year-to-year kind of prospect, isn't it, with Wayne? So what happens, how do you set the club up for the next 10 years? Is it just next season that you kind of plan for to do better than they have been?
Well, Wayne's the kind of coach that does well with the kind of roster that the Rabbitohs have. You know, lots of senior players, guys that are probably, we talk about premiership windows, if they're nowhere near a premiership window at the moment, but the kind of experience that can take them into that window. And the kind of coach is a bit of a player whisperer. So the kind of coach who can get people like Latrell on board, people like Cody Walker on board. I think the coach they go with depends on what Latrell's future looks like. You know, he signed until the end of 2027. He, you know, plays with his heart on his sleeve. He loves that club. But there are rumblings already. You know, does Latrell want to keep playing footy? You know, and I think it's way too premature to start asking those questions, but people will ask those questions on the back of everything that's happened in the last 6 months.
I spoke to someone close to him this morning about that, and, you know, I don't get the sense that Latrell's going to walk away now or in the next year. I think at some point Latrell probably will walk away. He'll probably walk away before his career is probably what many people deem to be the end, but I don't think he's at a point now where he's going to walk away. And I think the next 3 weeks are really vital for Latrell, because he's going to cop that ban, be suspended for, is it three games?
Three.
And he's fit at the moment. Latrell's as fit as he's been in a long time, so fitness isn't an issue. But there's certainly, even people close to him concede at the weekend, he looked a little disinterested, a little
frustrated,
a little fatigued by everything that's been going on around him. So I think the next 3 weeks he's really got to clear his head, and he might have a different coach come, you know, 2 weeks' time. So I think he needs to sort the next 3 weeks, just sort out everything else, get his head in the right place, and then hopefully you see the best of him. Because if you see the best of him, South can, they can mount a charge. I mean, I don't think the years. If they're 1-5, they're the sort of team, I think, that even at 1-5, they can string together. We saw it last year, at the start of last year, they won. So, you know, I don't think it's dead and buried, but he's got to inspire it, right?
Yeah. He's the guy. The guy. That's a, we always talk about South in terms of Latrell. It all kind of depends on him, and I think sometimes that weighs on him.
But
they really do need him to be.
I think you're right, Pam, because even when they weren't winning to start the season the first couple of weeks, if they were going to do anything, it looked like it was going to be on the back of Latrell. And then all of a sudden you've got guys around him who aren't playing very well, and he does have to carry that burden of carrying that team to a win every single week, which shouldn't be that case, because they've got guys like Damien Cook in the team, guys like Cody Walker in the team, you know, Jack White, and they've got a good team. It shouldn't all fall on Latrell Mitchell to be the main guy. So and I think that's part of his frustration as well. You know, he is trying hard. Maybe he did look a bit disinterested, as he said Reedy last week, but before then he was actually, you know, you couldn't say that South Sydney's poor performances were on the back of Latrell, because that just wasn't the case.
No, they also get bullied up front so much, don't they? They just get really pushed around.
The flip side of Latrell getting suspended is we probably get to see Jai Gray this week, who a lot of raps around Jai Gray, young kid, been killing it in New South Wales Cup. If he plays well when Latrell comes back, does he come back at fullback on the centres?
Well,
again, is that up to Latrell?
It depends who's coaching when he comes back, right? Like you said, he might have a completely different coach. You know, there are a lot of players who see themselves as a certain position. I mean, we've seen that with Zach Lomax in the last couple of weeks, the same with Latrell. People forget Latrell won premierships as a centre. You know, so if Jai Gray's the kind of injection of energy that they need, he's sort of really wily, can set up tries, even though he's quite small, you know, he's quite strong. So he's probably has a bit more of a work rate at fullback than what you're going to get from Latrell across the 80 minutes. So he might be the better option at fullback. But again, we're preempting, right? Like, his New South Wales Cup form might not necessarily translate into NRL, especially because they're going so bad. It's a bit like Dean Hawkins, you know, like you bring him into the side when the side's going poorly, you can't expect the world from them.
Well, the other side of that is, though, if you bring Latrell plays in the centres, right? He's a left centre, and a left centre probably alone, right? Jack White's playing left centre. Does that mean Jack goes to six? And then Hawkins is gone anyway, right? Because Cody's your halfback. So it's a bit of a major reshuffle, because Campbell Graham will come back eventually, won't he? At some point this year, Campbell Graham's turned back.
He's your right centre. But so, by the time Campbell Graham comes back, if they haven't sorted their stuff out,
the season's over
because they've got him down for a round 20 return. He reckons he might be back a couple of weeks before then, but even if it's round 18 or 17 or whatever it is, the season's done by then. And I don't know whether they're missing an organising half, and even though Jack Wyden is an absolute beast when he takes on the line and when he's on fire and the rest of it, he's probably too similar to Cody Walker. So I don't know if you're, you know, if you're trying anything at this point because you're desperate for wins, then why not?
You know, I think that'd be a reason to try it. Right? Yeah, like he's a good half.
Mm. Jack.
Yeah, absolutely.
He needs his hands on the ball a bit more. I like it.
Yep.
Yeah. I still think Latrell's their best fullback. But anyway.
Do you?
Yeah, I do. Yeah. Did we give him any hope? They gone or what? Putting a line through him? What do you got for us? What do you got for the fans?
Oh, just the poor fans.
Make a big call.
I think this is
line through.
Well, are they last at the moment? Or is it?
Yes, they're last. Stone
I wrote down before.
Even the Titans are above them. That's how bad they're going. Well, the Titans haven't won a game and they're above them.
Yeah. So that is
line through. Gone.
Yeah, I know it's only 5 weeks, but it is really hard to get a roll on.
Gone.
What we've seen. Yeah.
Yeah. Gone. Okay. Yeah, gone. I still give them a slight hope. They need to win this week.
You think they can make the eight?
If they win this week, they're 2-4. They get the bye.
You made us not sit on the bench on the fence.
I just said I still give them hope.
All right.
I still give them hope. They got to win this week, though. They got to win this week.
That means the Titans are a hope.
Who have they got this week again? I can't remember.
The Sharks.
Okay. Well, they probably won't win this week. They got to win this week. No, the Titans are no hope. They haven't won a game. But we'll get to them soon. Speaking of sides that are no hope, I shouldn't say that. What about last night? Parramatta. That was diabolical, Parramatta.
That was the nation's capital
against Canberra.
That was beautiful.
They were smashed. And this is their draw for the next 6 weeks. Cowboys, very tough. Dolphins, top of the table, aren't they? Dolphins at the moment. Manly, who can be hit and miss, but it's at Brookie that game. They've got a bye, they'll win that. Then they've got the Broncos and the Storm.
Yep.
It's a hell of a draw, and that's probably without Mitchell Moses. So we're putting a line through them.
Are you putting a line through them? You make the call.
They weren't my eight to start with.
Okay.
Yeah.
So when does Moses get back?
It was around 8 to 10 weeks, right? And he, when I had spoken to Brad Arthur about him right after he had surgery, he at the time said Mitch was hopeful that he could probably get back before his return date. But again, it's one of those injuries where he's your key player. You're not going to get him back early if he's not ready.
Well, the season might be over. Well, if they don't bring him back.
Well, again, chances are he could be back for that, maybe the Broncos game.
No, that's Broncos only 5 weeks Storm? Away. Storm, maybe six.
5 weeks being 2 weeks already?
Seven. Getting back at seven.
Seven is probably pushing it.
Yeah. Probably. So, maybe the Storm game, say.
Maybe Storm game.
Yeah. But
I don't like... they were terrible last night.
They were awful, weren't they?
They were absolutely terrible. And I was saying earlier, I feel like the Moses injury, they have enough quality in that side. There are enough senior players. Dylan Brown has shown what he is capable of at a representative level, and there's enough talent in that team that they shouldn't be getting flogged like that. They couldn't. It can't just be Mitch Moses is out, we lose our kicking game, and we get smashed like that. That's just unacceptable.
Yeah. Well, that's what it was, though. Like, Mitch Moses is gone, and all of a sudden that game management is gone. Like, you compare... the way Jamal Fogarty controlled that game, you know, he sort of kept them stuck in their own half with his kicking. He forced dropouts, like he just piled on the pressure, whereas there was none of that from the Eels. And then you compound that with the fact that they were just completely beaten in terms of run meters, particularly contact meters. Like physically, they just weren't in the contest. They were missing tackles, you know, and against a good Raiders side. I think people underestimate that when the Raiders are on, they're a pretty good team. But for me, it's, you know, I know Talangi's young and Brad Arthur backed him, and Brad Arthur did say when he went with him initially last week that we know he will get better with every game. The problem is how much more time does he give him before he makes a change? Because it's just with him and Brown in the halves, it's not working. So, you know, it's, I know Sanders is a bit of a, Ethan Sanders is a bit of a touchy one there at the moment. You know,
well, that's the bit I don't get, right? Because last year, apparently they told Ethan Sanders, when he wanted to go to Canberra early, they said, look, we need you because if Mitch or Dylan go down, you're our player, you're coming in. Then Mitch goes down this year, you're a natural halfback sitting in reserve grade who apparently is playing all right. He hasn't been playing shocking. Instead, you shuffle things around, put Dylan Brown halfback when he's not comfortable there. He can see that. And he's not a big talker. Blaise Talangi, he's going to be a really good player down the track, but apparently he's very quiet, right? He's not a really talkative kid. So you've got no direction, and you've got a kid sitting in reserve grade who's a natural halfback. That's what he's done his whole career. And it feels like they're not picking him.
Because he's going to leave them, right? Round six, right? Isn't that the deadline for these juniors?
So next week he can kick off talks again with he was already talking to Canberra, but next week he can kick off talks with Canberra and other clubs who are interested in him. I mean, I think he'll end up at Canberra, but you're almost cutting your nose off to spite your face because you're not picking this kid who's a natural half, and that's what you lack because Mitch is gone.
Yeah.
So it's, I don't know.
I mean, the Panthers did it. The Panthers did it with Isaiah Katoa. You know, when he signed with the Dolphins, they were sort of miffed about that and thought, you know, we've already put all this time and effort in his development, then we're not going to necessarily pick him.
The Panthers are still winning.
No, I get that, like, but as it happens, right?
Like, they have that luxury. I don't think Parra do.
No, they don't have that luxury, but it does happen. So
it would be interesting to see what he does this week, whether he makes a change in the halves this week.
I think they also need a little bit more from their kind of back five as well. They don't really...
Probably why they're chasing Zaki Lomax, I guess, right?
So, clearly.
Yeah.
So, Brad Arthur, where does he fit in all of this? Well, because we were talking about JD and expectations.
He is under the pump, right? Yeah. He's been there 10 years. The coming of a season, they didn't make the finals. And they started this year very indifferent. Mm-hmm. So, and with that run, they might... Yeah, there's every chance they win any of those games. I mean, they could be 2-8.
Yeah.
Season over, line through them. And then pressure really comes on Brad.
Yep.
Is a change as good as a holiday? Is that maybe what everyone needs?
Maybe there's a duel for Wayne Bennett, right? South and Parra go out and see who can get
Wayne. Who wins that duel, though?
If Parra was so insistent that they have not spoken about Wayne Bennett, they do not. They want to separate themselves so much from it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that was when Brad... At the start of the season, when Brad was under no pressure, right?
Starting to maybe look a little bit sweeter.
But just, there's got to be some focus come on him.
Because absolutely.
He's done an amazing job there, Brad, right?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Great job. Got into a grand final a couple of years ago. Mm. And, you know, he's been through salary cap drama and all sorts of stuff with them. But at some point, does it become, have you been there almost too long? And not won the big dance, right? He's got him to it once in 10 years, but is that enough?
It's not enough.
You missed the finals last year and then you missed the finals this year.
With the quality of players and the calibre of players he has, like, he's done an incredible job of building a roster that has put them in a premiership window up until, you know, the last 12 months. At some point, that's got to convert into success.
But, and I think, like, you hear people talk about, and you hear coaches and clubs, and you kind of hear this all the time, that players, they reach their peak under a certain coach, right? Like, you can only get so much out of people when you're hearing the same voice all the time. You're hearing the same, like, the same coaching methods. Like, perhaps we would see more from BA somewhere else.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Interesting, right? Because Brad's done a good job there. He'll end up somewhere. He'll get a job somewhere else.
Yeah, it's no doubt he can coach. Like, he's a great coach. Yeah. He's, you know, good man. Great.
Interesting
coach,
to see what sort of implications it has for his son, though. Matt is apparently a very good hooker.
Very good.
Yep.
In New South Wales Cup, so can't imagine he'd be happy if his dad gets result.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
That's a good point. Having said that, they do actually have, like Matt Arthur and Blaise, you know, a few other kids and Sanders coming through. So, you know, I don't know whether, I don't know. It's a tough one.
Do you think they make the change this week? Do you think they make some changes to their halves, or what are we thinking?
Do you think... I'm not sure Brad Arthur's the kind of coach that will go from one kid in the halves that didn't make it into Lungi to Sanders. Do you reckon? I think he backs.
I don't know
Talangi.
If he has a choice. I don't think you need to flick Talangi out. I think you have Talangi in the squad somewhere. Stick him back in the centres.
It absolutely makes more sense to have Sanders there. But do you have Sanders there for 1 week and then 10 days later he's announcing he's going to Canberra?
Here's a radical play. Maybe you put Talangi at fullback and Gutho on the centres. What do you think?
Let's switch it up.
Bit of X Factor.
Yeah.
We'll have him on the bench and bring him on. And like Gutho's playing great football.
Yeah, he is.
He's one bloke who never lets them down.
Yeah.
Canberra were good, though.
So good.
I love it today.
No, they were good. They were tough. They were brutal. They sort of keep coming. Matt Tomoko is quickly becoming one of my. He's definitely my favorite Raiders player.
He's a good player.
One of my favorite
Ethan
in NRL.
Strange. That's Ethan Strange as well.
Just the confidence he plays with. Jamal Fogarty probably isn't getting his dues. Like when they're on, a lot of
what was Hudson Young doing then? By the way,
I don't know.
Why did he pass that
How many bomb tries have there been to open the season?
I didn't think that was a try. I thought that pass went forward. But anyway,
no, as in they got that try.
This
but yeah, they've bombed so many.
Xavier
Savage.
This kind of speed. This is what Parramatta are missing,
especially in the outside backs. Yeah, right. Will Penasini. Will Penasini tries, but he doesn't necessarily have the speed of some of the other outside backs. So yeah, they're looking good. I'm not going to say they're a dark horse. It's only round five, but it's a long season. Like even Schiller, you know, comes into the side.
Yeah.
You've got someone like Nick Kotrick playing in cup, you know, at the moment because there's so much talent there. So
they just extended your boy Tomoko too, gave him another year.
Yeah, I don't know if you saw there was after one of the tries he scored, I don't know if it was this one, they were playing Sher.
Unreal.
In the Sher, you know how they play the songs after the tries and he was like mouthing the words to Sher, a Sher classic.
Oh really?
The Believe in Love.
Turn Back Time.
Not Turn Back Time.
If you
I think
believe
that one. Yeah.
Jesse James.
Love that song. Classic. No, they're a good footy team. They've got a bit of everything, Cam. Lots of bit of speed out wide. Xavier Savage is a flyer.
Yep.
Tough up front. Fogarty's become a really outstanding halfback, hasn't he?
Mm.
Just controls the game so well.
Absolutely. And Jordan Rapana, I think, God. Yeah. Every year I just think, maybe he'll dip off a bit
this year. I thought he was gone for an ACL there for a second. Yeah. All of a sudden he's
and Ethan Strange will, probably win Rookie of the Year. He's been that good. So
definitely.
Yeah, they should really be 4-1 because they should have been Cronulla when they were, 18-0 up last week or something.
Yeah.
So they'll be kicking themselves at the end of the year if that comes home to cost them.
I was listening to the radio this morning.
Yeah.
Guess who got a Dally M point?
I heard Dylan Brown.
And no Jamal Fogarty.
No Savage. Who's giving out those Dally M points?
Unbelievable. Ridiculous.
That is ridiculous.
That's shades of the hammer in round one. Is it round one?
Yeah. So
speaking of no Dally M points, let's talk about the Roosters because a bit of a crisis going on at the Roosters.
There are that many crises after round five.
It's your classic injury crisis. Right?
Well, there is an injury crisis in the NRL.
No
general,
Teddy. No Sammy Walker. Dom Young's not injury. That's through stupidity. I was sidelined for that game. It was one of the most ridiculous games I've been sidelined for. But how they even got back.
Yeah.
Well, Robbo gave us the lead after the game when he bizarrely said it shouldn't have been sent off. And I don't know what game he was watching. I mean, it was just insane.
It looks worse the more you look at it.
Oh.
You know what I mean?
Like
it's just. Well, I understand him sort of defending his player, but you've got to be realistic.
Yeah.
I mean, that's probably more, you know, knowing that the charge sheet hasn't come out yet, sort of trying to control
the narrative a little bit.
But he came across,
and to be honest, he looked a bit of a goose afterwards when the replay was shown. You could see he's got him flush on the chin.
And hard, too.
And it was a swinging arm. He said it wasn't. So, Robbo gave us an easy lead then, didn't he?
Yeah, he certainly did.
But, you know, obviously a lot of injuries out of that game for the Roosters. Teddy, a lot of talk about Teddy and the concussion history. He's come out publicly and said he's okay. Do we harbour concerns for him? Or?
Yeah. I mean, like, one thing, and it's the same with Kiri, right? Like, one thing that, you know, there is sort of some comfort to take out of it is they're both, you know, pretty switched on, smart guys. I don't think they're the type of players that would be putting their own long-term futures and health in jeopardy. And I guess he's got to trust that the Roosters will do the right thing by him, and I'm sure they will. But it's concerning when you see somebody who, and it's the same with Ponga, you know, it's just concerning when you see these players that do have a concussion history get knocked out during a game, you know, especially Teddy otherwise looks fit and healthy, so who knows how many more years he's got in his career, but he's definitely towards that back end of his career. So
I think the Roosters are one of those clubs, they've shown us repeatedly that they take this really seriously, concussion, and then they really go above and beyond, I think, to look after guys who are suffering these things. But the thing with Teddy is why it's maybe, like, it is a bit of a cause for concern, but not to the level that we've seen with, you know, Boyd Cordner and things like that.
Yeah.
Boyd was getting concussions just from innocuous things, small hits, and not being able to recover.
Yeah, Teddy's getting run
Teddy's
over.
That's true. Teddy's getting knocked out by, like, huge hits. Like, it's not little things.
And that's the kind of player he is, right? He's willing to put his body on the line as the last line of defence. So, but speaking of injury crisis, what about Canterbury out of that one? They have a longer list of, like, of injury crisis. So we sort of know who they are already. The only one that they were waiting for was Max King, but he was confirmed on the weekend that he had a broken arm. So there might be a lot of changes for Canterbury as well. Crichton, we might finally, Stephen Crichton might finally get to see him.
Start at fullback.
At fullback.
Yeah. I would say about Teddy, you're right, I was critical of Robbo before, but one thing Robbo's been really good at is managing concussions, so he's in pretty good hands there. In terms of the Dogs, I've been a bit critical of the Dogs over the past year or so.
But
they've improved this year out of sight, and that was a really good performance. And they'll miss Max King.
Love to see it,
because Max King, that is one area of the field where I think they haven't really recruited well. But he has been so good, Max King.
Yeah,
so good through the opening 5 rounds.
I have actually loved to see it.
Yeah.
Go the Doggies.
Oh, are you a Dogs fan?
No, I'm not at all. Oh. But I'm an underdog fan. And
maybe they should have.
I have been critical of them, as, you know, everyone has. They have been pretty rubbish, but I just thought this was really gutsy. And,
there was really a great game plan, because they just went after Dom Young early in the game and just, poor old Dom, they made mincemeat out of him. He got himself sent off in the end. You can see Viliami just...
And Viliami, you know, back to his sort of Penrith best.
He's so key for it, though, right? Yeah. Like, when he's playing well and he's just running hard like that, there's really nothing that anyone can do to stop him, and they've really needed to see that from him for a little while.
So I must say, this is Teddy getting KO'd. I must say, he's a big, tough dude, Viliami, right? He's a big unit. But, man, he stays down a lot. He's always getting injured in games. Have you noticed that? He's always got some sort of niggle that's going on.
Yeah,
and then he gets up and then he runs over the top of James Tedesco.
You can definitely put at least a power rankings of guys who stay down.
Yeah.
Definitely. But I think if you're a big unit like that and you work really hard, if you got knocked down, I mean, if I got knocked down, I'd just stay down too, probably.
Yeah, it's take me a little bit.
Take a little breather.
Maybe they should watch
Do we think they've turned the corner, the Dogs, or is it a bit premature? Mm. The Roosters, as good as they were, the Roosters in that opening 40 were as diabolical as I've seen a Roosters side in a long, long time. They were horrible.
Yeah.
They're definitely a better team.
Yeah.
Defensively, they're a better team. They've shown when their attack is on song that they can score points as well. I don't know, you know, if... Yeah, they're a better team. I don't think they'll finish bottom four.
Mm.
This year. So
I don't know if they've turned a corner. They've maybe just shown us what their potential
that they're
is.
They're on the up.
Yeah, this is probably... Yeah, exactly.
That they're on up. But you're right. They're probably... Even though Max King has played really well this year, especially on the back of that re-signing, they signed him long-term, I think, extended for 3 years. They're probably still missing a forward, and that's probably going to be tested this week when he's gone and a couple of other other guys are out. But Matt Burden took on the line, was threatening. Ciro's got a whole bunch of utilities, so I'm sure he'll be able to replace everybody out this week.
Just in terms of the Roosters, obviously a bit of controversy out of that game, and more to come this week, I imagine. Michael Jennings will play his 300th game this Thursday night in Newcastle.
Yep.
Normally the NRL celebrates these sort of things. You know, Andrew Abdo normally gives a presentation. a lot of speculation that maybe he shouldn't this time around because of Michael's history, not because of the drug ban. It's got nothing to do with that. It's all about the civil action with his was the ex-wife or partner?
Ex-wife.
Do you have a view on it?
Yeah,
I don't think he should do it for me. I mean, photos last forever, right, with the internet now, and I don't think Andrew needs to be seen the photo with Michael Jennings.
I completely agree. I just think it's the most awkward thing. I don't even... It's hard. I'm struggling to understand what the payoff even is for him coming back.
Like, why?
All of this controversy, just... We could have avoided all of this, all of these conversations, all of... You know,
where does the fault lie though with the club for even applying and bringing him back, with the NRL rubber stamping it?
It's probably a bit of both. I mean, if you look at the controversy now that surrounds the NRL over it, you know, are they going to have the presentation? Are they, you know, because people are going to have an opinion on it either way, right? This is a no-win situation for the NRL, and they've sort of created it by allowing it to happen. And, you know, Jennings is, we talk about the back end of the career, like he's right in the twilight zone of his career. And how many games are the Roosters, I mean, they do have, you know, injuries this week, but how many games are they going to
anyone imagine this?
This is how I think this has happened, right? Like, no one thought he was going to play NRL. Yeah. Like, they just thought, oh, you know, he'll run around New South Wales Cup and, you know, probably, you know, earn whatever his minimum wage contract or whatever. And, no one anticipated that this would happen, and that's really, I think that's the fault of the NRL for doing that. But I don't know what the payoff was for the Roosters to kind of make that application, you know, in the first place. Why?
Maybe, I don't know, another player that they can say is a 300 gamer. It is like a you know, a revered like milestone in the game. Yeah. You know, so few players get there, but. I don't know, you know, you could probably make an argument whether after everything that's happened in terms of the civil case, whether you want somebody like Michael Jennings, you know, on that list at your club. It's interesting though, because there has been a lot of talk about it. Initially, a couple of weeks ago, Robbo said something along the lines of, you know, Jennings wants to rewrite his story, and we feel like this is, you know, we can help him do that. You know, this is the club where he can do that. But I don't know whether, you know, again, that's one thing I remember hearing Robbo say that, and I'm thinking, why do you even want to touch that story, let alone, you know, rewrite it?
I really struggle with that. Like, why do we have to be the game that hands out redemption stories all the time? I think we don't need to do that.
Yeah. Anyway, I'm sure that's a decision they make sooner rather than later in terms of the NRL.
They don't have too long. What do you think they should do?
I don't think the NRL should do it. No, I don't think Andrew Abdo should be seen. As I said, that photo, it's my alarm going off at 10:49. Time to wake up, time to get out of bed. I don't think Andrew Abdo needs to be in a photo with Michael Jennings.
Yep.
The Roosters have applied to bring him back. Get the Roosters to do it.
Yep.
Get Robbo to present it to him.
Mm.
I mean, he's obviously driven it. So get Trent Robinson to present it to him.
Yeah.
But traditionally, like, the NRL sends out an email congratulating 300th player.
That's
is that going to happen this week?
Too,
this is all, it's just awkward.
Yeah.
It's very awkward. Well, as I said, I don't think anyone saw it coming. Let's touch on a couple of other games quickly.
Yeah.
Brookvale.
Yeah.
Well, Four Pines Park. Sorry, my wife works for Four Pines. She'll kill me. Four Pines Park on Saturday night. Unbelievable. DCE. Yeah. What a night for Daly. Champion of the game he is.
He is, yeah.
He's just a champion. Yeah. I think that had all the hallmarks of him scoring a try, a bit of an ambush.
Kind of threw a bit off, though.
Absolutely love it.
They were a bit off. This game changed on one of the great howlers of modern times.
What?
The knock on.
Oh, stop it.
Did you think that was a try?
It went backwards.
Oh, my Lord. That's been really knock on ever since the game started.
Tom it's an out.
What? This?
This is DCE. Tommy Talau looks backwards.
Oh, that's a knock on, man.
Because the ball goes backwards.
It'd be interesting to see what the NRL says about it, but you thought it was a knock on.
I thought it was a knock on. Yeah, I thought that was pretty clear knock on.
There have been some dubious calls on knock on. We went through a period, maybe I think it was last year, where every time a ball went to ground, it was almost instantly a knock on, regardless of which way it went. So I don't know. I saw that. When I saw that the first time, I thought, yeah, that's fine. He looked backwards, looking for the ball.
I'll tell you, it was unbelievable in this game.
Who?
Nathan Brown.
He's been good for them.
He was insane in this game.
Tommy Turbo was good in this game, considering that he had a shocker the week before.
Yeah, he didn't like being reminded of that during the week, Tommy, that he had a bad game.
he did have a pretty bad game.
But it is a good story, Nathan Brown, though, considering, you know, he said he was a train and trial, wasn't he?
He was unbelievable from the kickoffs in this game. You know, we'll talk about
how old is
banning kickoffs, and which I think will happen inevitably anyway.
You reckon?
It was a prime example of why kickoffs should remain, It was a bit of both, right? It was an example of why we love a kickoff, because we see these blokes charging in the defensive line. But it was also an example of why some people think they should be banned, because he hurled in the defensive line and got smashed every time and picked himself up, dusted himself off and went again.
Love it.
And it gave him
He just is a bit of a lunatic, and I love that.
It just got the crowd involved and everyone was on their feet. It was unbelievable.
Yeah, but there aren't that many guys like Nathan Brown who can pick themselves up and keep going after that. So, but having said that, I think there was an incident in the Cowboys-Titans game yesterday where they had the 20-metre restart. And it was the Cowboys were defending, and because they had the chance to sort of go through in a tackle, the middle player, it might have been Sam McIntyre maybe, got caught in it, and he knocked himself out from a 20-metre restart.
See that. Yeah.
So do you know what I mean? It's just these things in that initial collision, in that tackle one, regardless of whether it's a kickoff or a restart or, you know, you can't avoid them.
We should quickly touch on the mighty Titans.
Yeah.
Well, not so mighty.
Are you writing them off?
Well, they're 0-4.
Are they your wooden spooners?
0-4? 0-4.
Yeah.
They may not win the spoon, but they're not going to play finals footy.
If they don't, who else is going to at this point?
Someone could challenge them. South could, the way they're going.
Yeah, truly.
they showed a little bit towards the end when this game was out of reach, right? The Gold Coast showed a little bit, but...
But that was probably...
Did we take anything out of that?
No.
That was,
was probably more the Cowboys, you know.
Absolutely not. They've been taking their foot off. Woeful, really, really bad. Yeah. I don't know how else to kind of put it.
And that sums up their season so far. Woeful, really bad. The Gold Coast have been diabolical.
I kind of had bigger expectations. I know Tino's out, and you know Dave Fifita's been out for a little bit as well, and Jaden Campbell too. But yeah, I kind of had bigger expectations that we'd see a bigger change in them with Dez coming on board. I thought it would be more noticeable, but this is just.
Well, I think everybody thought they'd be better with Dez on board, just because. He's quite demanding, right? Mm-hmm. I think they thought that one of the problems with the Gold Coast is you go up there, you relax, the guys maybe don't go that hard, and Desi go up there and change things, but hasn't really worked so far.
No.
And you know, there's a bit of talk about moving AJ Brimson back to six, and they just don't, I don't know what the answer is there. They just don't.
They need someone else in the halves. They need some help.
Well, Kieran's probably going to be out this week. So, and Tanner Boyd actually played a right once Foz went off. I think Tanner sort of looked better. But maybe move AJ to six and someone else in the centres.
I think
AJ gets more ball, and if AJ's got more ball, they've got to be a better team, right? Because AJ's a good player. Well, that's not his finest moment.
Well, right on cue.
It's interesting, because the whole point of moving AJ into the centre was to sort of add another dimension to that attack and use his, you know, ball playing and his skills to sort of give them that edge in attack. But instead, he's almost just turned into a battering ram, and it's being sort of, you know, he's being underutilized, so to speak. So with four and out, it would not surprise me if they do move him into the halves this week. But yeah, they just haven't really shown anything.
No.
The first team in the NRL era, I think they said it in the broadcast, to concede 28 points or more for 9 games straight or something. Oh. So, you know, so there's clearly things going on.
Oh. I've got your mighty Raiders this week.
Yeah.
Down in Canberra.
I'm not going to say
another rough week. It's the day for Feeder Cup, that one. Big Davey boy.
It is too. I'm not going to say it's going to be a carve up, because the Raiders can be hot and cold.
Just declare it. You can declare it now.
All right, it's going to be a car.
Well, that's a good note to end on. Thanks for joining us on the... thanks, ladies. And thanks for joining us on the Daily Telegraph NRL Podcast. See you next week.